So, something a little different on this channel. It's the end of the year, and as a special treat, I decided to make a video about books. You see, last January, I made a New Year's resolution to read at least one book a month, and boy howdy did I ever overdo it. So, I'm gonna tear through the whole list and give you a review of every single one of them. No biggie, let's do it to it. First off, the novel Dark Matter by Blake Crouch, a soft sci-fi thriller begging to be adapted into a motion picture. It's about alternate realities, but doesn't bog itself down with pointless techno jargon because at its heart, it's really a book about life's choices and ultimately the possibilities in roads not taken. If you're a late 20s, early 30s sci-fi nerd contemplating marriage, this is gonna be right up your alley. Next, John Scalzi's The Dispatcher, another soft sci-fi thriller but not nearly as good. In the future, when death only affects 1 in 1,000 people, sending the other 999 safely back to their beds in the style of a video game respawn brought to life, one man is in a race against time as he investigates a mysterious kidnapping. I did not enjoy this book. Takes way too long to set up its premise, feels gimmicky, and the ending's pretty corny. But that's just me, lots of folks seem to like it. What do I know? Moving on, I read an embarrassing amount of Star Wars novels this year. Let's try and get through them as quickly as Rick Lee. Star Wars A New Hope, The Princess, The Scoundrel, and The Farm Boy by Alexandra Bracken. A fairy tale retelling of the first, I said the first, Star Wars film. I listened to this with my wife during a road trip. It only took about 5 hours. It's meant to be read by middle schoolers, which I did not realize until we started, but for what it was pretty okay. Star Wars Heir to the Empire, Dark Force Rising, and The Last Command make up what's called the Thrawn Trilogy of the Star Wars Universe. Disney's acquisition finally brought us new movies, but before then, these three books were basically regarded as the original series sequel trilogy. You can sort of think of them as what episodes 7, 8, and 9 would have been if Lucas had kept going with the story after Return of the Jedi instead of going the whole prequel route. These books are widely praised and often called the best Star Wars novels ever written, which isn't like, you know, saying much, but I did enjoy them. The story drags in places, and there are a few anticlimactic moments in the first two books. But if you're an original trilogy Star Wars fan and are willing to stick with it, the third entry brings everything together in a really satisfying and breathtaking conclusion, but be warned, it'll take a while to get there. I recommend going the audiobook route with these, as Random House went all out with music and sound effects, making each book feel like a 6-hour-long Star Wars movie for the mind. But if you're just looking for a short and simple dose of Star Wars that you can burn through in a couple hours, consider the next book on my list, Star Wars The X-Wing Series Volume 9, Starfighters of Adamar by Aaron Alston. It's part 9 in a series, but there's no entry barrier. I hadn't read a single book in the series before this one and had absolutely no trouble jumping in. I'm told it's one of the funniest and most entertaining Star Wars books there is, which, again, isn't saying much, but I liked it. It's a more lighthearted side story if you just need something to read during your morning commute. The last novel from the galaxy far, far away in this year's Block Promise is Star Wars Battlefront 2 Inferno Squad by Christy Golden. A more mature take on the Star Wars universe, this book serves as a prequel of sorts to the new controversial video game by EA. While it remains safely inside the PG-13 boundaries, it's nice to see an espionage-themed, deep undercover-type story set in a universe that I've loved since my childhood. Okay, getting out of Star Wars now. During the summer, I went on a bit of a Stephen King binge. I've only read a few horror books in my life, but never anything by him, and I wanted to see what all the fuss was about, so here's what I managed to get through before calling it quits. The Shining is one of King's classics, and it was the first one I read. It goes way deeper than the motion picture, and really unsettled me as a reader due to my own childhood experiences. I wasn't so much scared as I was wowed by the sense of dread the book invokes. It's a slow burn that leads to a quick and unsettling conclusion. A surefire mark of a good horror novel is that I never felt bored reading it, which is pretty remarkable given how long Stephen King novels tend to be. Like everybody and their cousin, I also tore through It leading up to the motion picture release. Well, tore through isn't really quite accurate. This book is really, really long, but it's probably King's masterpiece. This is the book he will be remembered for centuries from now. This book encapsulates childhood so well. The way the kids talk, think, act, it's all so authentic, and King can write children like nobody else in the world. A few parts in this book legitimately terrified me, and I found myself thinking about the the characters and the story long after I had finished reading. The movie is structured a lot differently than the novel. The flashback parts are by far the best content, so I'm almost certain the movie's upcoming sequel is gonna flop, unless they take a lot of liberties with the story, because the present-day stuff in the book is not nearly as strong. Fair warning, it is incredibly violent and incredibly unsettling, way more so than the movie, so if that's not up your alley, stay far, far away. Full Dark, No Stars is a collection of Stephen King short stories, which essentially means it's four different normal-sized novels wrapped into one collection. The first story, 1922, is the best in the book, very scary, very unsettling, but in an Edgar Allan Poe kind of way. The next three stories were really not up my alley and kind of ended my King fling for the summer. I eventually came back later in the year for the next book on the list, Sleeping Beauties, King's latest, written together with his son Owen King. You might say I'm reading this book clinically. Couldn't care less about the story, really. I'm just interested in seeing the differences in father and son's writing styles, and to see how King works in a collaborative medium. I don't think this will be one of his most remembered works, but I'm sure it means a lot to him personally, having worked on it with his son, and at this point in his career, he's more than earned the right to write what he finds fulfilling. So, save for a couple of books here and there, I think I learned this summer that Stephen King's stuff just really isn't for me. Next up is a sort of screenplay-turned-book. It's the novelization of Chris Marker's La Jetée. This is my favorite short film of all time, and I found this book version while browsing a store in London in July, so I immediately picked it up. La Jetée is a short film made of photographs, so a picture book like this is the only way to make it work in this medium. The movie is still obviously how you want to experience the story, but this makes a nice coaster book for obnoxious film snobs such as myself. The last fiction book on the list this year is Finders Keepers. No, not another King novel. Finders Keepers by Roy E. Deering. It's a nice children's book about honesty and fairness, with a good, healthy moral for fourth grade readers, the kind of thing the classroom would all read together as a school project. This is actually written by a friend of mine, so I picked it up to satisfy my curiosity and to help support a friend in his first published work. Moving on now to nonfiction, first up we've got a book that I try to read every single year. It's the one book in this video I would recommend to everyone on the face of the planet, Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence People. This book is the definitive guide on the subject, and making it a point to practice its teachings will pay off in your life in a big way. My relationship to friends, family, co-workers, strangers, everyone improved by reading this book. It also helped me to come out of my shell a bit and learn empathy for other people. If you want to take steps to cure your social insecurities, if you want to learn how to turn enemies into friends and have a healthier and happier relationship with your fellow men and women, if you just want to learn how to handle being on the phone with technical support, or how to talk to a manager at a retail store when you've got a problem, read this book. Speeding ahead, I'm giving a lecture in Texas this month on the 119th Psalm, and to prepare I had to read a lot of literature on the subject, so I'll go through these really quickly. First is Charles Bridges' Exposition of Psalm 119, the definitive book on the subject. It's a verse-by-verse dissection of the psalm. It contains a ridiculous amount of information. It took two reads to grasp a lot of the things it covers, and I'm sure to learn more and more every time I choose to read it again. Next is Psalm 119, The Diary of a Captive by Gene Cunningham. It's stylistically the complete opposite of the previous book, but it covers the same subject. While Bridges believed the psalm to be written by King David, Cunningham believed it was written by a prisoner during the Babylonian captivity, and this book covers the psalm through that lens. It's very easy to read, and I found it really helpful during my studies to put into simple words some of the more complex thoughts contained in the material it covers. Then I read The Golden Alphabet by Charles Spurgeon, which is basically just like Bridges' book, but with Spurgeon's signature style. It contained a lot of the same stuff as the previous two books, but it was fun to read the same information from a different author to give it a bit of a different perspective. Lastly, I picked up The Word of God and the Child of God by George Zemek. This was the hardest read of the four on this subject, but Zemek really dissects each part of the acrostic poem like word for word, and really provides a comprehensive, if somewhat overly clinical, analysis of the source text. Along the line of spiritual things, I also read through How the Great Religions Began by Joseph Geyer. It's a good book to learn the origins and the shortcomings of contemporary religions and denominations, but sticks with a pretty surface-level understanding of them, and some of the information is a bit out of date, as a few of the religious groups mentioned have altered their accepted doctrines since the book's original publication. George F. Beale's How Implications Revelation Binds and Silence Forbids covers some similar ground. It's a good but relatively unknown book about Bible hermeneutics, written really for professed Christians, as it asks them to truly consider if the Church of the Bible really worshipped and operated the way churches of today do, and what it means if it didn't. Roy E. Cogdell's New Testament Church also focuses on the same subject and has a much, much lower barrier of entry. I got this book as a gift and I really enjoyed it. Next is the book I'm not allowed to talk about by a publication company I'm not allowed to mention. I include it in this video because I read it, but I can't say anything about it yet because, well, alright, I'll just go ahead and tell you, I'm securing the rights for a motion picture adaptation that I plan to shoot in either 2018 or 2019. So yeah, there's that. Stay tuned. I only read one graphic novel this year, which is comically low for me. Haha, get it? Comically? Anyway, the one I read, I made the most of. It's the complete Star Wars Tag and Bink series by Kevin Rubio. I made a video about these characters earlier this year, and as a result of their resurgent popularity, both characters will be making a cameo in Solo, a Star Wars story, which releases in theaters next year. Seriously. I read two game books this year, Lone Wolf, Flight from the Dark, and Fire on the Water by Joe Deaver and Gary Chalk. I made a video about these, which will be out next year sometime, so stay tuned for the full review in that. They were just as good as I remembered them being from my childhood. I only read one book of poetry this year. It was Prodigals and Those Who Love Them by Ruth Bell Graham. Pretty short read, but a comforting book for parents with wayward children. It was gifted to me by a friend, and it's one of those books I can get a little bit out of right now, but years from now, will mean much, much more. I only read one biography, too. That's also a low number for me. This year, it was Elon Musk, Tesla, SpaceX, and The Quest for a Fantastic Future by Ashley Vance. Elon Musk is a fascinating person who is constantly walking a tightrope between being the most important figure of the 21st century or the biggest failure, and watching that balancing act has been equal parts entertaining and compelling. I have no idea if Musk is going to get humans to Mars, but I'm glad to live in a time where his vision is at least possible to attempt. The biography is best when discussing the beginning of his life and his rise to power, but it delves a bit too hard into hero worship toward the end, but I still enjoyed it, and it's probably the best biography of Musk that's out there. And last on this list is what I affectionately call my yearly boring book. So each year I pick one book that either covers a topic that I am totally uninterested in, or a book with an absurdly boring title that next to no one is likely cracked the spine of. I do this for one main reason. Reading and learning seemingly useless information is one of my favorite things to do, and oddly has served me well in life to put things that I do care about into proper context and to simultaneously help me look outside the box concerning subjects I usually spend way too much time obsessing over. So this year I picked Bus Rapid Transit as an Improved Public Transport System for Megacity, a study on Dhaka City, Bangladesh, by Kamanashish Haldar. So Dhaka is a city of close to 19 million people. It is the fourth most densely populated city in the world, and it continues to grow every year. Because of its geographical location and the population's socioeconomic situation, there are many different modes of travel around the city, some motorized, some not, and they all share the same roads. This causes constant traffic congestion. It is a complete nightmare, and nobody quite knows what to do about it. The city lacks a much-needed organized public transport structure. So this book proposes a bus rapid transit system to alleviate congestion. It is fascinating to look into the otherwise boring science of mass transportation in densely populated areas. I walked away from this book with the impression that there is no answer to any of this. There are just too many people living in too confined a space, and there is no way to solve things in a way that's financially feasible or culturally pragmatic. As far as I can tell, no one on earth has actually read this book, but me, and I doubt that that will change anytime soon. Alright, so overall, I've really enjoyed increasing the volume of books I read yearly. In 2016, I think I only read 6 books. When I was in school, I read about 12. This year, I got to read through 29, and it was not only immensely educational, but also therapeutic. Reading takes you outside yourself and provides all kinds of emotional, mental, and intellectual benefits. People should read way more than they are. You should be reading way more, too. You really should. You're not going to get the nourishment and satisfaction that you need in life life from watching hours of live streams on Twitch or video game Let's Plays on YouTube. You're just watching people all play the same games, consuming the same content, and regurgitating the same opinions on content that barely moves the needle on cultural or intellectual significance. We all know this. So this year, do me a favor and read books. No, books that nobody else is reading, and talk about them with other people. Join a book club, write about what you learn, and start saving the world. Sure, video essays are nice, but the vast majority of them are poorly researched, poorly edited, and they're all analyzing the same stuff, so I mean, what's the point, right? So let's help each other in 2018 to get outside the hive mind and start learning and discovering again. Seek out information that is offline, hard to find, and can profoundly impact your life and the lives of others for the better. And Happy New Year. Thanks for watching these past few months. And before I forget, I've got a Patreon now. I'm working really hard on it to provide tons of worthwhile exclusive content, and it's the best way to get an intimate look at my life as a content creator and to connect with me in a way more meaningful than YouTube comments. If you've got change to spare and want to help support me so that I can keep improving this channel in the coming months, I'd really appreciate it. Thanks. See you soon.